What's up, peeps? This is Senor Tortas talking. I know it's been a while since I uploaded a video. It's been over a year. I've been a little busy. But, you know, I'm gonna try to get a little more content up on my channel. Try to do some MLB The Show videos. Try to do also, definitely when 19 comes out, try to do some franchise mode there. Because it's my favorite mode. And, you know, it's my channel. I'm also going to try to do a little more baseball highlights. Not your traditional player individual. I'm going to try to build more of a story around different clips that I can find. But, you know, that's wishful thinking. I do get a little busy. But, we'll see. Anyways, my first video of, you know, this new era. This is MLB 18 The Show. And this is a franchise mode. This is 2020. Some players that I've acquired over the years include Edwin Diaz. I acquired Jacob deGrom this season at the trade deadline. I acquired, I acquired Mike Trout and Mitch Haniger. I've acquired some good players over the years. I want to focus on these statistics that the show has that not many people know about, or I don't think many understand or apply. And so I want to just take a little quick gander into this. I'm going to start with the position players. It's basically, and these are career stats that I'm looking at, because I'm in the playoffs right now and they don't let me like switch over to like the regular season. They just let me switch between the playoffs and career. But anyway, let's look at this on-base percentage. It's like it takes into account your walks, your hits, your hit by pitches, how many times you just get on base, which is one of the bigger contributors that a player can make to a baseball team, because the more you get on base, it's more likely that the more runs you score. And obviously, how do you win? By scoring more runs than your opponent. So basically, anything above 375-ish, I'll say, is elite. And on-base plus slugging, you basically add on-base percentage and slugging percentage. And it's a real easy way of, you know, showing you who the best players in baseball are, best hitters in baseball are. Mike Trout obviously has one of the higher OPSs in all of baseball history in his career. You see Corey Seager, at this rate he's going to be a Hall of Famer. Cody Bellinger, 893. Mitch Haniger, 891. Justin Turner for his career at 813. And this franchise has kind of tailed off the last couple seasons. Still really good. Actually, he was really, really good this season. In 2020, he had an 864 OPS, but not nowhere near like the 900 OPS levels he put in 2017 and 18. But he's still really good, and obviously this is way down because in his career, earlier in his career, he was a role player, basically. But yeah, OPS, basically anything above 900, you are the cream of the crop. 850 or above, I'll say, cream of the crop. 850 is more like B-plus players, 900 is A players. 800 OPS, that is, that's still a B player, still a very good contributor to your team. 750 or above, you're a good role player. Anything below that, you are just horrible offensively. Like, how do you have a job at Major League Baseball? Probably because you're really good with the glove or something. But yeah, anyway, that's OPS. It's a very, very easy stat for anyone who doesn't follow baseball. Basically, it's basically like in grade school, you know, 90 or above A, 80 above B, 70 above C. You know, you basically follow that and you know who's a play, what kind of player it is. Runs above replacements. Now this is an imperfect statistic, but it's kind of like it's kind of your one-all stat to really show you the value of a player with how he contributes in offense and defense and base running. You see Mike Trout here in 2020 is a WAR of 85, so he retired. He's a first ballot Hall of Famer. I mean, he has higher WARs than like Derek Jeter, Vladimir Guerrero, Mike Piazza, I believe. Correct me if I'm wrong, I think he has a higher WAR than Ken Griffey Jr. It's very high. This is elite. I think the highest was Babe Ruth. He had 100, around 150, something like that, maybe more, around that number.
And then he makes his famous gesture.
Well, I looked down at center field and I saw it. I said, I'm going to hit the next pitch ball right past the flag pole. Well, good Lord, must have been with him.
But yeah, this is really good. And like I said, it's an imperfect stat because you don't know. I mean, here, obviously, I think in the show it doesn't do a good job of really incorporating into it because Mitch Haniger has a 9.4 WAR, and he had a really good season 2017, 2018. I think WAR above 3 each of those seasons.
Fair ball. Valbuena thinking extra bases. Haniger digs it out in the corner. And
what a tag.
Oh, what a play by Segura.
What a throw.
And then the last couple two seasons, he's been hitting at like a Mike Trout level for me. So I don't think this does a good job. The show did a good job using WAR. And I think it did an even worse job with pitchers because over here, you'll see Clayton Kershaw has a career WAR in this game of 18.5. Now in real life, I think it's more like 60. So that's kind of my little grind with the show here. I think they need a better way of a better way of just using WAR, of putting all the variables into it. Walk percentage, how much you walk out of all the plate appearances, all your plate appearances. Anything above 10 is pretty good. You see Mike Trout here, 14%. Corey Seager, 10.8. Justin Turner at 9. Cody Bellinger, 12.7, which surprised me. He does walk an awful lot. It's just he also strikes out an awful lot. A 24.8 K percentage. Basically, anything above 20%, you're known as a strikeout guy.
Home run!
Mike Trout here, 20.2. I mean, Mike Trout does have his fair share of strikeouts. He's been improving in that the last few years. I want to go to, in this franchise, Anthony Rendon signed with the Marlins, which really pissed me off. I was after him. I gave him a pretty good offer, and he went to the Marlins, which is something that MLB The Show should fix. I mean, these franchise trades and signings are unrealistic. The money that you give is unrealistic, the years, and I think you should have more contract extensions, which I think you are doing with 19. But I think there should be multiple like options to, you know, give your player options, team options, and all that incentive-based things. You should be able to trade more players in 1-3-team trades. I don't know. I just think, and I've noticed also that it doesn't follow the rules of the current CBA. It follows rules more of the previous CBA. I don't know. I'm actually kind of debating actually buying MLB 19 show.
Debating actually buying MLB 19 show.
Because like
the
I
blasphemy.
Said, franchise
the
mode is my favorite mode. And it really seems that they haven't done much to improve it, or at least make it the standard that it is, that it should be. Jock Peterson, I traded him to the Marlins. He has a walk percentage of 13.4. He strikes out 23.2% of the time. Now we know that. We always know he's a good power hitter against righties. He walks a lot. He strikes out a lot. Anthony Rendon, though, here. This is why he's one of the most underrated, one of the more elite players in the game, and why I think actually the Dodgers should go after him instead of Nolan Arenado next offseason. But that's a thing for a whole other, that's another video, you know. But Rendon, he walks at a 12.1 clip. That's pretty good. I mean, that's really, really, that's, like I said, anything above 10, you are amazing. But the thing about Rendon is he walks at a 15.8% rate. I mean, look at that. 12 to 15. I mean, that you just don't hear that. And the only guy I remember was that had something like that was Justin Turner back in 2017. Okay, so yeah, look at that. 10.9 to 10.3. His walk to K, his percentages and his walk to K ratio, I believe, was 1.05. I mean, that's unheard
Beast
of.
Mode.
ISO isolated power is slugging percentage minus batting average. This basically shows you the raw power that a player has. Mike Trout, 261. Cody Bellinger, you know him as a raw power hitter. He's at 260. Story, ISO, 254. Arenado, 245. Arenado went to the Cardinals. I tried to get him. I did make an honest play at him, but I preferred Rendon to Arenado, and ultimately I got none of them. But yeah, 245 ISO. Slugging percentage minus batting average. It really shows you the power hitters from the non-power hitters. Max Muncy here, 221. Anything above 200, basically, you're a power hitter. Power speed number. This basically, it tries to combine your player's power and speed all into one. It shows you who the all-around players are. So yeah, it combines the home runs and your stolen base into one number. And so, like Mike Trout here, you have a good overall... Whoopsies. You have a good overall player. He has a power speed number 263 in his career. So it's basically... These are your Willie Mays type players, your Ken Griffey's, your Mickey Mantles, your A-Rods. Because these guys... you're going to get a good offense, right? From them, because they hit a lot of home runs. But I mean, when you add speed into that, that translates not only into the batter's box, but translates into the field. You know, because... It's more likely that the faster you are, the better you are as a fielder. Mike Trout in center field. You see here Cody Bellinger. He's a very versatile player. I'm going to go to the Red Sox. Mookie Betts, 155.9. Ooh, Dustin Pedroia. Look at that. That's surprising.
Pedroia launches one in the left. At the wall. Pedroia, two-run shot. Red Sox up three.
The higher power speed number that you have, you're more likely a five-tool player. Secondary average, this is actually a new stat to me. I tried to research a little. I'm still trying to wrap my mind around it, but basically it's what batting average isn't. So like, it takes into account your extra bases, your walks, and your stolen bases, and it subtracts total bases from hits and caught stealing from stolen bases. This is per at bat. Basically divide that, you get your secondary batting average. No, 334. Okay, we'll use that as benchmark, 334. I think that is like the league on base percentage, somewhere around that, 330 something. So like I said, I'm not really familiar with this stat, but I mean, I think it's a good starting point. Beyond the box score defines it as simply offensive production apart from the hitting for average part, including walks, extra bases, and stolen bases. The formula is total bases minus hits plus walks plus stolen bases minus caught stealing all over at bat, divided by your at bats. I guess so, yeah, because, you know, batting average doesn't tell you everything. Batting average is a very old stat, like it's been around forever. But it's very rudimentary. It's very old school, you know. It still has a good place in today's world. I mean, it's not like wins. Wins and losses are basically useless.
One strikeout shy of 1,000 for his major league career.
McGraw, glove in front of his face. End of the windup. Here's the payoff pitch. In there, strike three called. He got it with a slider. Strikeout number 10 for Jacob DeGrom.
1,000 strikeouts for the masterful Jacob DeGrom. Every reason for Jacob DeGrom to smile after finishing one of the most phenomenal seasons of pitching we've ever seen, with a tremendous flourish. His 1,000th career strikeout to finish off 8 scoreless innings.
But batting average, you know, if you have a 300 batting average, you're a good player, supposedly. But the flaw with batting average is, one, it's a lot of your hits, it's very luck-based. Or, I mean, some of your hits are very luck-based. If you have a high batting average on balls put in play, you're going to have a higher batting average. You have a lower average on batting average, lower batting average on balls put in play, you're going to have a lower batting average. But a lot of that has to do with luck. BABIP is what I'm talking about. And so like we saw last year, Bryce Harper, through the first half, he had a ball batting average balls in play of under 200, which was really, really unlucky. He was still hitting the ball hard. He was still hitting it at a pretty, in that good range launch angle and that high exit velo that says you're a good player. He's hitting around that mark. It's just his BIBIP was low, and so his batting average was like at 200. It was at 214 at the All-Star break, if I'm not mistaken. And so, obviously, Bryce Harper's not a 214 hitter, but the batting average balls in play said he was, because he just downright had bad luck. And again, I don't know how to quantify luck. I wish I could. That would help me a lot, actually, but I can't. I don't know how. batting runs. There's batting runs and runs created, and they are a little bit different. Batting runs is basically, it's kind of like runs created, but what it does, it takes into account like your ballpark and like the era you're in. It adjusts for your home ballpark and the offensive era that you're in. I guess it'd be kind of like one of those OPS plus or weighted runs created plus, but it tries to put it all into one quantitative number, into one counting number, I should say. So I guess that's what batting runs is. If you don't know what OPS plus, weighted runs created plus is, OPS plus is basically like 100 is league average, and so anything above that, you're above league average. That's OPS plus, and it takes into account, it factors in the offensive era that you're in, so that if you do that, you can compare like how good a player is right now with like in the steroids era and the dead ball era. What weighted runs created plus, WRCP plus, is, it takes into account, it's like OPS plus, but it, furthermore, it takes into account your home ballpark. So like a Coors Field factor, or you're playing at like Citi Field, it takes those into account, and like some variable, some constant, it puts it all together and shows you how good you really are compared to other hitters in that year. Again, 100 is league average. So like Nolan Arenado, excuse me, he would have a very high OPS plus because he's put up some monster numbers over the last few seasons. But he would have a lower WRC plus, which he does, because, you know, obviously he has a Coors Field factor. Coors Field lets you have a higher batting average, and, you know, there's thinner air. So, you know, balls are going to travel at a more frequent rate for a home run. And so, like, Anthony Rendon, he has a higher WRC plus than Nolan Arenado, which is why I think he's a much better, he's a greater overall player than Arenado. If you don't like it, I know it's like blasphemy to say Anthony Rendon is better than Nolan Arenado, but the truth is, you look at the stats, he is. But yeah, Anthony Rendon has a higher WRC plus than Arenado, and so I know it's not here, which is, honestly, I'm kind of disappointed that the show doesn't have, I think, at least one of those two stats, OPS plus or WRC plus, that should be included in these statistics. But I think the batting runs is the closest thing you got. It's, again, a counting number. Stolen base runs, it's like how many runs you contribute base running wise. It's like those base running runs you see on Fangraphs. It's kind of like your war for base running. Kinda. You see here, Trout has 42. These Dodgers aren't very fast. Muncy at 1.5, that's pretty surprising. Charlie Blackman 11.7. Let's see, he was a fast player. Nationals. Trey Turner 37.2. You see, the more stolen bases you have, this is like the more runs you contribute to your team. Runs created, this is a very, this is an older stat, founded by Bill James, but this is a very good stat to show you a player's overall value. And the formula is total bases times hit plus walks. You divide that by at-bats plus walks. So it's basically like plate appearances. You divide that by the plate appearances, but it doesn't take into account your hit by pitches. It does take into account in the numerator. And so it's basically all the total bases that you have, and then you multiply that by the hits and walks. So like, a single is one total base, a double is two total bases, you add those up, you have three total bases. So all the number of times that you have that over the course of the season, you multiply it by hits, you multiply it by hits plus walks, and then you divide that by your plate appearance, or excuse me, your opportunities, your at-bats plus walks. So let me see. So right here, runs created, Mike Trout, he has over 1,000, man. I mean, this is, wow. I mean, do you need any more proof that Mike Trout is like the greatest player that ever lived? Justin Turner, 661. Yeah, it's pretty high. Turner, you would think he would be lower than like a Corey Seager, but Turner, he gets on base a lot. He has a very high slugging percentage. So yeah, I can see it. Runs created is another great counting stat. It's just, I don't know. I don't know if I'm explaining this well. It's just, I'm like a baseball nerd.
Nerds! Well, let's get those nerds! Nerds! Nerds!
A very sabermetric guy. I try to apply as many stats as I can, and trying to teach that as best as I can, but I'm not sure if I'm a great teacher. So, okay, so that's the hitters.